Hey there everybody, it's Nathan Cool with NathanCoolPhoto.com, and in this video I want to talk a little bit about triggers, and in particular some of the changes that have happened over the last few months and as they pertain to what we do for real estate photography. Now, as you may know, for real estate photography there's two types of triggers. We use them for shutter releases, we also use them to control the flashes. Other genres of photography use that as well, but it's especially important for real estate photography. So what I've done, I've got some white paper, some background paper over top of my kitchen island here. I've been doing a bunch of lab testing using different speed lights, obviously, than how triggers would work with the various mono lights, and then of course a whole slew of different triggers here. So I'm going to get in close and start diving into some of this. Now, I've done some other trigger videos here just recently, some of them on the white balance issue. I'm going to touch on that also here, but I'll have links throughout and you'll see them up in the cards where you can find those. And also you can search for trigger on my YouTube channel here and you'll find a lot of information. Also have a lot of information on this throughout my real estate photography series, in particular books one, that's the interiors book, and also the book on my new lighting guide, which is book six. So with those, if you're not familiar with them and you do want to take a look at that, I have a link in the description for this video to that REP series, the real estate photography series, but you won't necessarily need them for this video. But of course, if you're unfamiliar with triggers, this would be a good place to start also. So anyways, let me get in really close and start diving into some of the changes that have come along, go through my various notes, some of the test results, and how things are compatible, not compatible, some of the changes that have come along. And then finally, I want to give some of my recommendations going forward to what you could use for real estate photography when it comes to triggers. Ready to get started? Let's get in close and take a look. So first off, one of the easier ones to talk about is cactus, and you may have seen from prior videos and also throughout my books, I talk a lot about using cactus triggers as dumb triggers. Triggers that could just do some very simple things. It could be versatile. This was the V5. Unfortunately, it got discontinued. I love this trigger. It was just a single pin type of transmitter. So just a simple dumb trigger. It had no effect on anything else in the camera. Had a nice mount so you could put it on light stands or on other clips like I'd show, like for wearing on my belt, for using it as a shutter release. But that did get discontinued. So now the replacement that Cactus has come up with is this beast, which is known as the V6. Now, you used to be able to buy a pair of these V5s, and that would run you just about 70 bucks. Now you have to pay $70 for just one of these monstrosities here. Now, this is way too big to be using as a shutter release. This thing is heavier, it's bigger, it's just bulkier. Now, what they tried to do is put everything in here to make it the kind of the Swiss Army knife of triggers, and now, in my opinion, it's just become useless. It does have some advantages, but it is way too bulky. It's way too much for a shutter release. I have other recommendations for that. Now, once again, for shutter releases, you may be using a cam ranger, and that's all good. You know, from past videos and throughout my books, I'm not a fan of it for a lot of the interior stuff. When I'm doing elevated shots, that's one thing, and some designer work, but for the most part, for me, I find it to be a little bit too cumbersome. So I like to use just simple triggers for my shutter release. I used to use the Cactus. That's been discontinued. So nowadays, if you're getting into using real estate photography, you don't have any of these cactus triggers yet, I'm going to get to my recommendation for a much cheaper one and something that works very well. But this guy here, Cactus, not for shutter release, but it does have some advantages when it comes to using it for flash. Now, one of the things that you can do with it is it is multi-pins. You're going to have a whole bunch of pins on the bottom, and immediately that starts screaming of potential problems that you could face with the white balance issues as other triggers. I'm going to get to that near the end too when I start covering some of the R2 Pro stuff. But anyways, it doesn't have any effect when you put this in the hot shoe. I did some testing, and one of the advantages is that it also has a default setting, so you can just do a different type of flash where it really doesn't use anything. So being in transmit mode, you can see here there's a lot of stuff you can do with it. All these various groups, all kinds of channels, supposedly talking then to its other cactus triggers. So a lot of versatility. They say that you can control power on all kinds of other flashes. I haven't been able to do that. You have to have other receivers of these on there. Just too much, way too cumbersome to do it. But in their menu, they do have the ability to set this thing. They call it the default. Excuse me here, I'll set the channel back here to 3. So that's it. They call that the there it is, the profile for the flash. You set it to manual and you should be okay. Then it won't show up as anything in the hot shoe. I didn't have any problems with it anyways, but in case you do and you have some white balance issues, that would be one way around it. So it does have some advantages. It also works well for doing trigger stacking. So for instance, you know, one of the things we did with the white balance issues and trigger stacking is that I would take the R2 Pro trigger and I would trigger stack it inside of the hot shoe for the cactus trigger. You can do it also not just on the V5, but the V6 does that as well. So of course you would just slide that and there you have a trigger stack. You could put that on your camera and then you wouldn't have those white balance issues that have been notorious on these Godox and Flashpoint triggers, which like I said, I'll get to and just recap on that shortly. So anyways, it does have some advantages for that. Also, it communicates well to just about everything. So this is a real trigger where the sync port on the side here does communicate out to monolight. So if you want to connect this to a monolight, you can. That sync port works well with that. And of course, then all kinds of other flashes. So I tested it on all kinds of stuff, YN560, YN562s, YN563s, TT600s, the R2 zooms, also on Nikon speed lights. Everything worked well. There weren't any communication problems with that. But once again, it's for me, the cost at $70, having it only for flash, it might be useful for some instances, but I think you're going to find as I go forward here, some of the better instances. So right now, this is my lowest recommendation, and it would only be if you did use it for the flash, but not for shutter release. Next up are these Yongnuos. They're the RF603s, and this, by the way, is my new recommendation for the triggers for shutter release. So unlike the cactus triggers, where the V5 was very versatile, and of course some of its size made it that way, it was a very simple trigger to use, didn't really have a lot of bulk to it, had a very simple way to change the channels and also to turn it on and off, and that was all great. But now that the V6 is there, the V5 has been discontinued, and the V6 is way too expensive, this is my recommendation. You can pick up a pair of these along with your shutter release cable for about $32. So very inexpensive triggers. Excuse me. They come in different OEM brands. So for instance, Yongnuo will have, this is a RF603N, which means it's for Nikon. There's a C for Canon. All different types. So you can go onto tons of sites and just go ahead and Google the Yongnuo RF603 and you'll find one for your camera model. And that's important because it will then come with its own shutter release cable. Now it's a little bit different. The shutter release cable that they have, obviously this is then for the Nikon mount, what they have. They use the real small little, what is it, 2.5 millimeter, but that's fine because you're really not going to use these for much else. I'm going to cover what these really mean for flash. There's a disadvantage though to using these as a shutter release. A couple things you have to be aware of when you do that. One, they don't have just RX and TX like most triggers. They're a little bit bizarre and they have TX and TRX. So you might think, okay, well, my transmitter that I'll hold in my hand or pocket or put on my belt, I would put that over to TX, and then on my receiver I'd put that to a TRX, but that's not correct because the Yongnuo is so weird. Their sync port here is really only used for a certain type of input, not output, so you have to have both triggers set to TRX. So you need them both in TRX mode, not just the one in your pocket, but also the one on the hot, going into the camera, the one in your pocket. So that would be good for shutter release. So this all works fine and dandy for shutter release. And the problem, of course, is it's small enough you could put one of these in your pocket. Putting this on the camera can be a little bit difficult because then you have to hang it and there's really no mounting for it. So what I've done, and a simple recommendation, you've seen me do this before for a lot of other stuff where I'd use this little belt clip here. And I'll have a link down in the description for this as well where you can find this. But the problem is that like this would normally go into it's a tripod mount. This would go into, for instance, where the cactus trigger in the bottom. But since there's no mounting hole there, you need to come up with a little hot shoe adapter. So having this little hot shoe adapter, and I'll have a link to these parts in there. You just spin that guy on there, and then of course you can then slide this guy into uh, it's really a cold shoe, not a hot shoe. So you can go there and then clip that on your belt as you want to. These guys, by the way, too, have a little screw here. Might be hard to see on this close-up, but that prevents it from falling farther out of there. So anyways, really good for shutter release mechanism, but when it comes to doing flash, it really falls short, because unless you're going to be using nothing but Yongnuo lights, then you might start having some problems. So using a YN563, YN564, that's not a problem. You can set these to the same channel as what you would, for instance, a Yongnuo speed light. So the versions 2 didn't have the ability to do that. If you take a look at here, I'll just bring over a 562, and you can see they don't really have any way of controlling any type of flash, or excuse me, groups and channels to work with it. Here there's all kinds of group channel stuff, and it's some funky menus and all that, but as long as you get those to match what you have set inside of these triggers, you're fine. But one of the things I didn't like about these is that there's no channel setting on the outside like you would have if you were working with the older Cactus triggers where they had a little thumb wheel. So what you have to do, it's very simple, just got to remember what you're doing, is that inside of each one of these, there's a set of dip switches, and those dip switches then you set to whatever channel you want. And when you're working with the YN563 or the YN564, you'll see that exact same set of dip switches when you go to change those settings. So anyways, that will work fine doing the shutter release, and also then for the flash, because you do have to have all of that stuff matching up. Now, when it comes to the flash, and besides just using the YN, you can use some other stuff as well. So you could put, for instance, any other single pin speed light in there. Take, for instance, like R2 Zoom, or for instance, this right here happens to be a Godox TT600. It's got a single pin, so it doesn't have any problem talking with that. But if you notice, this is a multi-pin receiver and transmitter, and that's made for the particular brand of speed light. So there it matches up to a Nikon. This is an SB700. Now that all works fine, and you can then control those, but it's really just gonna do nothing more than control speed lights. The sync port won't do you any good trying to connect this to a mono light. That sync port right there, it's just this input only thing, and it's really meant just to be a shutter release. So for flashes, these guys fall way short of what really could be used, unless you're just strictly Yongnuo and just using using speed lights. But as soon as you get into using any other bigger lights, these guys just fall way too short for doing it. Not my recommendation compared to other things that are out there today, in which I'll also get to shortly. But even though they are multi-pin, just wanted to mention that they don't have that auto white balance issue, which you will come across on the Godox, the R2 Pro stuff. So anyways, let's move on to that next. Let's start getting into that Godox line and the Flashpoint line and some of the issues to be aware of with that. Okay, moving on, I've shown this trigger quite a bit. Of course, we know that this can have some of the white balance issues, but this is the R2 Pro by Godox. It's known as the X Pro, and they come in different brands, obviously, for the different OEM types of camera, so you can control high-speed sync and TTL and all that. This is not for shutter release. It's way too complex for that, but this is a great commander that can sit in your hot shoe. And you can control all the various groups of flashes. So you could have multiple flashes, and that's what's nice about real estate photography. When you have speed lights and or mono lights or whatever that might be around a corner or another part of a room, you can just sit there, this sits in your hot shoe, and you can start controlling that. The problem is, I've shown before and in that prior video, is that since it's a multi-pin connection, it's trying to do the TTL and HSS with the camera, it's improperly identifying itself, which then causes auto white balance to be off. And of course, for real estate photography, we rely heavily on auto white balance. It's the only auto setting that we use, but it's important because this, the colors in the house, it's the totality of everything, not just what comes off our flashes and of course what it can cast. So anyways, it does have those issues with the white balance, but like I showed before, there's a lot of things you could do with it. My best recommendation is that since it's multi-pin, you use just a single pin adapter. So a very simple single pin adapter like this. It costs about $10, and you just then slide your trigger into that, you mount that on your camera in the hot shoe, and then you're good to go. You then will isolate just that single pin and nothing else will interfere with it. So that will get rid of that white balance problem. Another versatile way, and I showed it with the Cactus trigger, but I'll bring back the Cactus V6 just to show it once again. Same type of thing where if you don't use that, you want to have some more versatility, you can trigger stack something like this. That would then go in your hot shoe of the camera, and then you've got the best of both worlds where you've got one trigger that's controlling, for instance, the Godox lights, you've got another trigger here that's communicating to possibly some other compatible receiver triggers, in this case receiver lights that might be non-Godox, but they have a V6 like this connected to them that's in RX mode. So that can be used also. Another thing though that's also as a recommendation, if you do have incompatible lights, instead of doing the trigger stack like this, once again, if you're using nothing but Godox lights and you want to get rid of that white balance problem, all you have to do is just use this single pin adapter. So no big deal there. That's a real simple fix to use. Just slide this guy in there in the hot shoe and you are good to go. That's not an issue. But Flashpoint has another trigger. I gave a review on it. You can see I've got a link to that up there in the top of the screen, and that is the what they call the R2SP, and it stands for single pin transceiver. Here it is upside down so you can get a good view of it. Now I've already done a review on this, but once again, this is a very versatile trigger. So I want to talk a little bit about that next and what you can do with it in combination with the R2 Pro. It is a very, very versatile trigger, and I'll just prop it up here so you can get a better look at it here. You can see it's got a decent display on it. It's kind of on the small side, really not that big to work with, but at least you can control all the various groups, A, B, C, D, and E, and all that. And once again, on the ergonomics, check out that review video that I did. But it does work for a lot of stuff. Since it does have a hot shoe connection here, you can use this for a lot of instances, not just as a transmitter in your camera, which it's single pin, so you don't have to worry about any of the white balance issues, but you could use your R2 Pro on the camera, and it can then communicate to this. So this can be set as a receiver. So not just a transmitter, but it can then be turned on as a receiver. And then when it is, you can control then which channel you want to have this on. So let me turn that on. You can see right now this is set as a receiver for group B. You could set it for some other group as you see fit, having some problems there doing it. But that's the idea, is that this guy could then be a receiver, and then your R2 Pro would be a transmitter. So you could hook instance into that. Let's say you've got some Yongnuo lights, you've got like this Yongnuo 563, you just have to connect the Yongnuo 563, excuse me, just slide that, it's hard to do this from a distance, but you just put that on there and you're fine and you're good to go. And you've got your setup to communicate then from the R2 Pro that would be in the camera's hot shoe to this, which is connected then to some other disparate light. It's also got a sync port on it. So the sync port here is does work with other mono lights. So if you have something like some Einsteins or whatnot, or some other, like a Nikon light, or some other off-brand light that isn't Godox or Flashpoint, you can connect those mono lights to it with that sync port. It does work very well. The only problem, of course, is that if you are using a speed light, the speed light does cover up the controls over here, so you need to be able to set those controls first before you do that. Now, the nice thing about this, the R2 Pro, if we just turn around here so we can kind of see, the R2 Pro, that runs about 70 bucks. It's a great transmitter for the price. When we get into this, the single pin version, then that's only about $25. So it's a fairly versatile little guy for doing single pin work. And at $25, it really can't be beat. So if you're using a bunch of different lights, you want to have some type of compatibility between them, I am recommending to move toward Godox and Flashpoint, because over the last year especially, they've just really kept up with their product line in comparison to a lot of the other manufacturers. Cactus, in my opinion, has just fallen by the wayside. They tried to make some monolights, completely failed. They once again discontinued their V5. It was a really good trigger, and they made something way too cumbersome for it. And just a lot of other people trying to catch up, like Nikon and whatnot, but they just haven't done it the way Godox and Flashpoint have. So that's my recommendation. So if you are just starting out, obviously the R2 Pro is fantastic. Get some isolation on it by using like the single pin adapter, like other alternatives that I show in the other video. If you have a migration point where you're trying to use other lights that aren't Godox, then this would be the way to go. Once again though, not for the idea of using shutter release. So this is the flash recommended setup to use right now, using the R2 Pro and the R2 SP for any incompatible lights, and you can just hook this into those. I wouldn't use this as a transmitter. Use this as a transmitter just to isolate the single pin. And then, of course, for the shutter release, that's where then we get into using these guys. This is a fantastic setup. So for about $32, you can get this whole kit right here. So you've got yourself your, I'll put it up here so you can actually see everything that comes with it. This is where you get not just the two triggers, which one is transmitter, one's receiver, but you also get a shutter release cable. So for $32, you've got yourself a very inexpensive shutter release setup. So that's in a nutshell some of the changes that have happened with the triggers as we're moving into 2020. And I know this was kind of a long video and there's a lot of stuff to describe here, and there's even more triggers than just these that are out there. So once again though, just to kind of recap, my recommendation going forward is for the Godox Flashpoint line, and especially when it comes to as far as the flash units go. So my recommendation then is using the R2 Pro, but to have some type of single pin isolation on that. If you're then migrating over new lights, then using the R2 SP. When it comes to shutter releases though, if you're using Cam Ranger, you don't have to worry about that. It's not my way to go about it. I don't really care, as you know, to carry that extra tablet around on my neck and have to worry about charging then the Cam Ranger. I've had way too many problems with it not being very consistent. We're using a very simple shutter release mechanism, for instance, before just using the Cactus V5s, I'd have that on my belt and I'm just walking around pop 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 going through really quick. But of course, if you're not used to doing that and you're not used to some of your exposure settings, you want to have a little bit more control. Cam Ranger is the way to go. But for $32, you can get yourself just a pair of these Yongnuos. Comes with a cable. You've got your shutter release mechanism. It's small enough to put in your pocket. No big deal compared to buying a Cam Ranger, which is a few hundred dollars, and of course an iPad or some other tablet on top of that. So once again, you can also then keep this just a clip on to the camera. I showed some of that setup. Links once again down in the description for this video. And this can also clip to your belt if you want to do it that way, like I've shown before using the Cactus V5. Anyways, I hope this video was useful for you and that you can use some of this in your photography as well. If you did like this video, you can subscribe to my YouTube channel. It won't cost anything, and as soon as one of these videos is posted, you'll be the first to know. Thanks a lot for watching. Until next time, take care, be safe, and get out there and shoot something.